Hi there, everybody. My name is Lauren Spring, and I'm an art educator with the Art Gallery of Ontario. We are so happy that you're joining us today because we have a really special session planned for you this morning. I am joined here, you can see on video, I have my colleague, Maria Sullivan, who is the head of conservation at the Art Gallery of Ontario. You might have a hard time seeing her because she's in a Rembrandt photo type Dutch Baroque kind of lighting there. So she's in the dark. She's actually joining us from the Michael and Sonia Kerner Center for conservation. And she is the head of conservation. And so you can see how unique an environment she works in. And we're going to be discussing all sorts of different things today about conservation, about imaging technology, and so before we delve into that, I just want to make a quick note that the virtual school programs are made possible through the generosity of the AGO community, and especially the Michael Young Family Foundation. Here is our beloved art gallery. For the time being, we're still closed. We're really hoping we'll be able to open our doors to you very soon. But in the meantime, we're taking full advantage of what we can do in this virtual space, because on an ordinary tour, we wouldn't actually be able to go and visit Maria in the conservation center. And so here in this weird and wonderful virtual world, we can actually get a sneak peek kind of behind the scenes at the AGO. So there's one advantage to this. I also want to take a moment to acknowledge that the land the AGO is on is Mishki-Sagag Anishinaabe territory, Mississauga. It is also governed by a treaty between the Mississauga of the Credit and the Canadian government. Toronto is Mishki-Sagag Anishinaabe territory. It has also been occupied by other Anishinaabe, the Haudenosaunee, and the Wendat Confederacies. Okay, so here we go. So a special session. This one is designed for high school students, but if you're older than that, younger than that, and you're tuning in, you're more than welcome to join us today. So Maria and I will be talking a little bit about the work that she does in the conservation department. And we will also take your questions throughout. So if you have questions about anything that she's saying, you're welcome to type them into the question and answer box in the bottom, and we'll answer them as we go through. And Maria has also selected some really great examples of pieces that she's worked on that have been, you know, on the walls of the AGO before, to highlight some of the excellent imaging technology that we use and the importance of light and all sorts of other things within the art and science of conservation. So Maria, why don't we just start, if you can let anyone who's tuning in today know, what is conservation? What does it even mean in the case of the AGO?
Yeah, so thanks, Lauren. In conservation, we are responsible for the care and preservation of the collection. So we take care of the collection here at the AGO, and we try to preserve it as much as possible for the future. But if things get damaged, then we certainly address those. We do restoration. But one of, I think, the most exciting things that we do is to look at the art as objects, as material objects. And we try to learn more about them to help us preserve them for the future, but also to understand more about them and how they were created by the artists, what materials artists used and how they used them and how they might have changed over time. And today we'll be talking about technical imaging and how that can help us learn more about artworks, which is really exciting.
Amazing. And can you just let us know what is technical imaging?
So we'll go through some of the types of imaging that we do, but it's basically the imaging that I'm going to talk about today is using different types of light to learn more about the objects. And maybe we can go to the next slide.
Sure.
And so this is the electromagnetic spectrum. And the electromagnetic spectrum, you might recognize this from your science classes, but this basically describes all the light that exists. And we're all very aware of visible light. We can only actually see a very small part of the light that's that exists, and that's the visible. So you see that in the center of the spectrum. So there's a lot of information we can get using visible light. But we also can use special cameras and equipment to get more information about artwork using infrared or ultraviolet or x-rays. And so these are different wavelengths of light. Infrared is, if you think of, it's just beyond the red of the visible. And it basically is heat energy. And so we have some special equipment here that we use to be able to capture infrared. We also use ultraviolet. So if you think about light that comes from the sun, this is the type of light that we use sunscreen to block because it's so damaging to our skin. But ultraviolet can also give us a lot of information about paintings. We also use x-rays. And this is the same technology that's used in hospitals if you've maybe broken a bone or used at the dentist to x-ray your teeth. And again, this also can give us a lot of information about paintings and different densities of materials. And Lauren, maybe it makes sense to have a quick, I'm actually here, as you mentioned, in our conservation photo studio in the Michael and Sonia Kerner Center for Conservation. And so I can give you a quick tour of the space and you can see some of the equipment that we use to do this imaging.
That would be wonderful, yeah. So we'll focus on Maria's camera and yeah, feel free to give us a little walk around of your workspace here. We see some cool, looks like lights that are shining on a canvas there.
Yep, okay. And so then I'm gonna walk over here and if you can see this, sort of funny machine on the floor. That's our x-ray tube. So that's what we use to generate x-rays and take radiographs of paintings. And then just behind that, there's a large rectangular light. And that's our UV lamp that we use to generate ultraviolet light to do ultraviolet imaging. And next to that is a smaller lamp. And that's basically a tungsten halogen lamp. And it gives a very warm light that we use for regular photography. But it also gives out some heat. So it actually gets quite hot when it's on. And so that heat is basically infrared and we have a camera that can capture that. So I'm going to, I'm going to put this on the stand now and I'll show you our camera next.
Okay.
All right, so you should be looking at the painting and here is our camera. So it's basically a digital Nikon. And we've actually had it modified. Most digital cameras that you buy have an internal infrared filter and we've had that taken out so that we can use this camera to do imaging in the infrared, visible, and ultraviolet regions of the spectrum.
Wow.
So, but there's a lot of, we'll talk about the ultraviolet and infrared and x-ray in a minute. But there's so much that we can learn just by looking with visible light. So this is a painting by Jan Steen, a 17th century Dutch painting. We'll look at it again in different types of light. But you can see the color, you can see the painting. Another way that we can get more information is by using I'm just gonna change the light here. If you can see this, we could use a strong light at a low angle. And that gives us a lot of information about the surface. So this might be a little hard to see, but there's actually a gouge here, which is an old damage. That might be a little hard to see. And then there's a line, if you can see this line here.
Oh yeah.
There's actually not a lot to see because this is a panel, so it's very flat, but in with something else, you might see a lot of texture. So there's a line here. This one's harder to see, but there's also another one here. So even though this is one painting, it's actually made up of three pieces of wood. And that's the original construction. So it's one piece of wood here, another in the center, and then another at the bottom. And they're joined together to make this painting. Go ahead.
I'm just going to say, at the beginning of the session, you said, it tells us more about them and you're talking about art as objects, right? And it's so neat that, if you were to just walk by this in the AGO, you might not notice that little gouge you were talking about. And yet it is an object, right? And it's so full of stories and every, thing it's been through, it leaves a mark in some way or another that we now have the technology and you have the expertise to help uncover, more of the story of this actual object, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, there's so much. a lot of this is sort of detective work. So there's so much that we can learn from just looking closely. I mean, we also use microscopes and things to look even more closely and other types of imaging. But just with visible light, there's so much that we can learn, and even more with the other types of light. Maybe we should go to the next slide, Lauren, and start to talk about some of the other types of light.
Sure. See, I have the Kathleen Munn slide up here now with infrared.
Yeah, so this is a painting by Kathleen Munn, painted around 1925. And you see the visible normal light on the left, so that's what the painting looks like. And on the right, you see an image with infrared light. So this is really interesting. It can give us so much information, because the many pigments and binders are actually transparent to infrared. So this means when we look at things with infrared light, and we can't see them with our eyes, we can only capture them with a camera. But when we look at an infrared image, it can give us information about what is beneath the paint. So we're almost looking through the paint to the underdrawing that's beneath the painting. And so that's where the artist is maybe just sketching out ideas about the painting, what might happen. Sometimes they change their mind. I have a detail next. Maybe we can go to the next slide, Lauren.
Yeah, there we go.
So this is a detail of the head of the figure. And if you can see those lines through the face and through the shoulder, you can see that there's a very detailed grid of lines. And so that's how the artist planned out this painting. So especially later in her career, Kathleen Munn was very interested in the idea of the golden ratio. And so she used that very extensively in her paintings. And so you can go in and look at these different grids in her paintings and how she planned her figures and the painting. So these lines aren't something that you can see if you're looking at the painting, but with infrared, we can capture that and understand better how she was planning her paintings. So it gives us a little bit of insight into the artist's creative process, which is really fascinating. And she used these lines, and she painted very exactly following that initial plan that she made. Sometimes artists do make changes, and that's really interesting to find as well.
But I really appreciate what you're saying here, Maria, especially, you know, an artist, there are certainly ones that are more abstract expressionists, and there's not this kind of meticulous, careful planning, but certainly Kathleen Munn was one who was way ahead of her time, right? She was one of the first in Canada to be using these kind of, you know, really interesting kind of cubist techniques almost that she's importing. She had studied in the States and everything, and she largely wasn't recognized in her own life. And so now with this technology, we can, you know, already we knew, wait a second, she wasn't given the attention and the accolades she deserved, but now we can even delve deeper and say, wait a second, look at all of this amazing work that she did even beneath the surface here.
Yeah, absolutely. There's just so much we've been able to learn about her painting technique and how she worked, and that just, you know, it just builds the body of knowledge about her work, which is so exciting.
Yeah. Shall I go to the next slide?
Yeah, let's go to the next one. So this is the painting that you saw on the easel, a painting by Jan Steen, a village festival, from the 17th century, probably the middle of the 17th century. And as I mentioned before, it's painted on a wood panel, actually that's made up of three different pieces of wood. So you see the front of the painting on the left. And this is something that you don't see when you're in the galleries, but on the right side, you see a picture of the back of the painting. So this is what the back of the painting looks like. And that's really interesting too, right? That can give us so much information about the work. And actually what you see on the back of this painting isn't original. It's something that was added later. So you see those battens of wood that are running in different directions. We call that a cradle. And that's something that was adhered to the back of the panel, probably within the past century and a half, to try to keep the panel flat. So that's a treatment that was done at some point, a restoration treatment, to try to stabilize the painting and keep it flat. And so the other thing to note is in near the center of the painting on the back is this red wax seal. So that will come up in some of the imaging we do later. So, you know, looking at different information from the painting lets us know that, you know, this has been treated before, gives us a lot of information about the history of the painting.
Interesting.
Should we move on to the next one?
Okay.
So this is the same painting in with ultraviolet light. So this is looking at the ultraviolet fluorescence of the painting. So when we look at a painting with ultraviolet light, we're basically shining ultraviolet lights on the painting, and the materials of the painting actually give off a visible fluorescence. So that's actually visible light that we see coming from the painting, but materials all react in different ways. So that can give us a lot of information about the materials there in the painting. And so what you see is this sort of hazy yellowish film over the surface. And that basically is the varnish layer. So ultraviolet is great as a surface technique. It gives us a lot of information about what's on the surface of the painting. So we can see that this has quite a thick natural resin varnish. The color is very characteristic of a natural resin that was probably applied quite a long time ago. Some of the other things you can see are those dark spots sort of just below and to the left of the middle. And those correspond to a damage, and someone has likely gone in and retouched those. So a different binding media, more recent binding media, tends to appear very dark. So this can give us a lot of information, not only about the surface coating, the varnish, but also about changes, additions, restorations that have happened. And you can also see those lines where the wood panels join. Even though those are original joins, those tend to be areas where the panel moves a little bit and tend to be areas where they're, you know, that are more likely to be damaged. So those appear darker because there's been retouch along those lines. So someone has come in and used newer paint to fill in where older paint was missing.
And now Maria, you mentioned, yeah, you're kind of like a conservator director. detective. And I'm wondering, like, if you were to look at this painting with normal light, would you, with your kind of conservation detective eye, be able to think, oh, I think there might be a little bit of damage in that spot. Let's put the UV fluorescent on it and verify? Or would this be totally not visible, even to an expert like you in regular light?
So, that's a great question. And it really depends. Sometimes those restorations are very carefully done and almost invisible to the naked eye. We might be able to see them under the microscope, but ultraviolet is one of the first things we go to, because then it helps us understand where we need to look more carefully. And so it really highlights those very effectively. Sometimes if they're not so well done, then you can see them quite easily, but often they can be harder to find.
Oh, interesting. All right, shall I go to the next slide?
Yeah, please.
There we go.
So these are radiographs of this Jan Steen painting. And a radiograph is basically an image that's taken using x-rays. So we don't use our camera for this. We have, like at the hospital, we have plates that we use in conjunction with our x-ray machine to take the image. And then we put those plates through a digital processor to get the digital image. So on the left, you can see, because those wood strips on the back are very thick, they are more radiographically dense than the rest of the painting. So you end up with this really distracting grid mark on the back. So we can use special software to basically minimize that grid and end up with the image on the right, so that we can look more closely at the actual painting, the paint layers. And again, this can give us information about areas where there is paint loss. So for example, along there are some areas, especially along the lower joint, where it's much darker, and that's where paint has been lost. And then if we look at that light of that very bright white mark near the center, that's the red seal that we were seeing at the back of the painting. So that's a wax seal, and wax is not very dense radiographically. So you wouldn't expect a wax seal to show up. But remember that that wax was red. And so because it's so dense radiographically, we can hypothesize that red color is obtained using red lead, which is very dense radiographically, or something like a vermilion pigment, which is another type of red that was commonly used that contains mercury. So lead and mercury are both very dense radiographically and would show up very, very brightly like this, would appear very light in the radiograph.
Interesting. And do you have any idea why? Like, why was that wax thing put on, that red wax?
It was probably someone's mark, right? It was basically done to say I was here in a way, right? Often there's a stamp in the seals that will have lettering, and in this one it's not decipherable, so we can't connect it to anything. But often there's lettering or a specific mark, and you can tie it back to certain guilds or certain groups. So that can give us a lot of information about where a painting's been, where it's come through, if it's been through a certain studio. So again, just more and more information about an artwork.
Yeah, that's fascinating. All right, onto Rubens now.
Great. So this is the Peter Paul Rubens Raising of the Cross from around 1638. It's an oil and paint on paper that was later mounted onto a canvas. And I'd like to look specifically at that central group because there's some really interesting things going on there that you can't see in visible light. But when we use some of our other techniques, sometimes some of those hidden treasures jump out. So Laura, maybe we go to the next image. And so on the left, you see a visible light detail of that central group. And then on the right, you see the radiograph. And so there's something there that the artist added originally, and then he decided that he didn't want it as part of the composition. So if you look, there's actually a dog in the lower left corner where Lauren's indicating. Lauren, I think if you go to the next one, it'll actually do a circle there as well.
There you go, yeah.
Yeah. So there's this fabulous dog hiding underneath this painting. And so, you know, I don't know why Rubens decided to paint it out. He probably wasn't entirely happy with the composition as it was. And sometimes artists did different versions, and Rubens was known to have done a few different versions of this particular scene. But the dog was painted out, but it's a lovely dog, and it's really fun and really interesting to be able to find something like this in a radiograph. It's still there. It's just under paint layers added in by the artist, painted out by the artist. So that's one of those changes that I mentioned that just helps connect us to the artist's process a little bit more.
That's so neat, huh? And you just wish Rubens was here and we could be like, were you just unhappy with the leg? Or like, did a patron tell you you didn't like dogs and put it on his wall and so you had to paint it out? Like, yeah, and that it's so neat that it still actually does exist and you can just access this little creature now.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, and it's just a happy little thing, right? Just so lovely and really beautifully painted. And you can see that in the radiograph. It also shows up in the infrared, which I haven't shared today, but you know, these techniques, the radiograph and in infrared photography in particular, let us see so much about the image and more than just what you see there, which can help us learn so much more about the paintings.
Oh, yeah, these must be exciting days in your conservation center, huh? Do you ever you say, "Oh, I'm gonna use an X-ray on the Rubens here"? Gather around. Guess what I found? You're never gonna guess what was down at the bottom.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, it's always really exciting to find something like this. Absolutely, it's really thrilling.
Oh, it must be. We have another 2 or 3 minutes for folks who are tuning in. If anybody has any questions. If not, I'll ask some because I've got lots of questions hearing Maria's expertise here. But if you do have any questions, feel free to type them into the the Q&A box. And maybe, Maria, while we wait for folks to do that, I'd be curious to know a little bit of your background, like getting into this. Were you more kind of studying sciences or art or both? How did you end up working in this field?
Right. Well, people come into conservation from different paths, as you suggest, from science or from art. I actually had my grandfather was a restorer in the Netherlands. So it was a profession that I was aware of very early. And so I knew it was something that I wanted to do. So when I went to university, I managed to do lots of art, lots of studio art, and lots of chemistry and science so that I'd be ready to move on to graduate school in art conservation. Conservation is this really interesting mix of art and science, which for those of us in the field, we just love it.
It's true. There's few professions, I think, that are such at a crossroads. Like this real kind of hybrid mix. And yeah, and folks might not know, I mean, part of Maria's job is, of course, finding out, doing this detective work and finding out more with this this technology. But also, Maria, I imagine you do a lot of the restorative work yourself too, right?
Right, yeah, absolutely. I mean, we have a whole team of people here that work on this. And, you know, to be fair, a lot of the projects I've shown today, I haven't actually done myself, but other members of the team have been very involved in them. And yeah, actually the retouching is definitely something that we do as well.
And we have a question from a student here. How big is the conservation department at the AGO?
So we have 9 full-time people in the conservation department and 3 part-time staff. And so conservators, we all specialize in different materials. So my background is as a conservator. You know, I would say we have one of the larger conservation departments in Canada. Probably the AGO and the ROM and the National Gallery are the 3 largest departments in Canada. But so we're quite large for a museum in Canada. And conservators specialize in paintings and paper, contemporary art, photography, sculpture and decorative art. So there's this whole range of expertise that different people have.
And it's true, and folks who visited the AGO before, you've probably walked around noticing, yeah, we have lots of, like you're seeing with Rubens here, we have lots of kind of oil on paper, oil on canvas. That's what people tend to think of when they think of an art gallery. But then, like Maria's mentioning with, you know, contemporary art, I remember we had one not too long ago that was milk on marble, right? And there's a lot of kind of really unique materials that it makes sense that you need people with very different backgrounds and very different materials to kind of be the experts on. And I think we're actually almost at time now. So I'd like to take the final kind of few seconds that we have today to thank you so much, Maria, for giving us this behind the scenes AGO Conservation Center view. I know it's just fascinating stuff for me. Every time I've met you and one of your colleagues from the department, I just know you're full of so many stories and stressful moments touching things up, and, you know, things that don't go as planned and amazing learning that takes place. So thank you so much for sharing some of your knowledge with us today.
Yeah, thank you, Lauren. It's been really exciting.
My pleasure. And thanks everyone for tuning in today. We hope you enjoyed this session and we'll see you again soon. Bye.